The children's BBC, you'll find it on BBC Two. Here on BBC One, Grand National Grandstand with Desmond Lynham.
Good afternoon from Aintree. The Martell Grand National has picked itself up, brushed itself off, and hopefully starts all over again.
Press, public and staff, will you please evacuate all buildings, including the parade ring area, the paddock, and move to the centre of the court away from the stand.
70,000 had to leave on Saturday. Many of them are back today. It's taken a lot of work, but the fences are now back in order. On Saturday, the people left, the cars remained. Today, no cars, just people. On Saturday, the jockeys left in their riding boots and breeches. They're back today, and they're ready for action.
There have been two coded bomb warnings received by the police, and there is no possibility of taking any chances. Consequently, we're going to abandon racing for today and make a further announcement later. So I just ask everybody here, including you from the BBC, to leave the course and get out onto the public highway immediately.
Well, we hope the BBC coverage and Peter O'Sullivan's milestone commentary was just postponed. The horses had weekend board and lodging. They're now about to face their daunting task. Security for the restaging of the National is absolutely at a premium. Well, Lord Darsbury is with us, the chairman of Aintree. Peter, how important was it to restage this great event here today?
Well, the Martell Grand National is the greatest steeplechase, but more than that, it's a unique sporting occasion worldwide, and we've had terrific support from the racing industry, the racing public, to restage it.
Yes.
So we had to.
And so you felt to do it sooner rather than later was better? Do it today rather than, say, leave it for a week or 2 weeks or something like this?
Absolutely. I mean, it becomes very difficult for trainers, obviously for the horses. We had to do it straight away.
Now, the security today has had to inevitably be rather intrusive of the people. I mean, how do you feel about that? And do you feel that everything will go off okay?
Well, obviously, after what happened on Saturday, the Merseyside police had to put a very strong contingent out today. I have every confidence for them. They've done a fantastic job. I think we will be able to stage the race today.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. So there we are. We hope that we're off and running.
They're not going to jump in. Well, they are going to jump, but they can't believe it.
It's Grand National Monday. It has a different feel. Let's have a look around. There are approximately 70,000 people here on Saturday. Inevitably, there are far fewer here today. And this part of the stand, which is usually absolutely jam-packed, as you can see, there are a good few hundred there. We don't know what the total will be. It'll probably be 8,000 or 10,000 people here today, I would imagine. And the familiar jumps out on the course are usually thronged with people, as you know, as the runners go by. Well, the security have not allowed the public to watch the race from out on the course today. Everybody is obliged to watch from either in the stand or just in front of the grandstands here at Aintree. But as we said just now, the fences have been put back in order. That's probably the most famous of them all, Beecher's Brook. And again, at the canal turn, there's usually thousands of people watching the race from there because you get spectacular shots from there. As you know, you're very familiar with the sights and sounds of the Grand National when they make that spectacular 90-degree left turn. And the people enjoy watching it from there, but you've got the best seat in the house, of course. Now, let's just tell you that two horses have withdrawn from the National from the 38 starters that we had on Saturday. As you know, two had already pulled out, Master Boston and Plastic Space Age. Well, Belmont King is a withdrawal now and Over the Stream. So there'll be 36 starters for this Martel Grand National here on this Monday afternoon. Let's take a check on the betting for you for those 36. And Go Ballistic, the Gold Cup fourth, is now a clear favorite at 8-1. Sunny Bay, the Grey, Lord Gyllene, and Lord Gyllene are 9-1. And Wild Hyde is 10-1. Los Dragoni, ridden by Graham Bradley, having his 11th ride, is a 12-1 shot. Northern Lad, one of Jenny Pittman's runners, 14-1, and that's come in from 20-1. So quite a lot of money's moved on for Northern Lad. Smith's Band is Jenny's other runner. We'll be talking to her in a moment. Master Oates, the top weight, is a 25-1 shot. Cheers you can hear in the background. There's a presentation being made to Richard Dunwoody behind us. But just to go on with the betting, Evangelica, there's been movement for this. That was 40-1 on Saturday. It's 33-1 today, the only mare in the race, ridden by Robbie Supple. Dextra Dove is the other grey, of course, in the race. Newco is one of the Irish hopes. Irish haven't trained this race, the winner of this race, since the 70s, as I'm sure you well know by now. Joe Tizard, the 17-year-old who we spoke to on Saturday, who rides Straight Talk, has had a busy Sunday. He's been riding in point to point. Had three rides yesterday, I'm told. Straight Talk is a 50-1 shot. And Celtic Abbey is now ridden by Richard Johnson. Brendan Powell was to have been the jockey on Saturday. Richard Johnson now gets the ride at 66-1. Now the real outsiders. Chris Bonner, though, has got a good record in the National. He's had two rides and finished, I think, fourth and fifth in the last 2 years. But these are the 100-1 shots, the big outsiders. There we are, the 36 runners for this second attempt this year to run the 1997 Grand National. Jenny Pittman is with us today, as she was on Saturday at every Grand National day, and you got very emotional on Saturday, and people understood that, of course, but you cheered up yesterday, I take it. And
yeah, will you cheer up a bit? Come on. The crowd's here, they're having a lovely time. Come on, Des, it's great to be back here. And you know, the race course, the police, everybody else, and yourselves, of course. I don't know how much you've been putting this together, but
we've been trying. We've been trying. And what about your two horses?
Yeah, they're in very good order. They've drunk all the water that you'd expect them to drink. You know, they've not left anything, and they've ate all their food, and That's the most important thing. When they're away, sometimes they can worry and get a bit finicky.
Where did they stay overnight? Where did they stay?
They went to Haydock. They were wrapped up in their duvets and went to bed early.
Right.
They do have duvets, honestly, double bed duvets. Keeps them warm.
Some of the trainers have taken their horses a long way away. I mean, for example, Paul Nichols, I was talking to, took his run and right back down to Somerset and brought it back today.
That's Paul Nichols, it's not Jenny Pittman.
No, you wouldn't have done that.
We've got enough food for plenty of oats and plenty of nuts for the horses.
Yeah.
We were going to run short of hay, and a horse's digestive system is very delicate, so I didn't want to change the hay, so I had to ring my hay merchant, Robert Tompkins, and said, Robert, I need a favour. This is Saturday night, about 11. And he said, what is it? I said, I need some hay by lunchtime tomorrow. So he was up at 6 and took the hay to Haydock for me. And, you know, it's people like that in your team that support you. The farrier, Mickey Towler, he's been up here since Friday night. Now then, lad's a difficult horse to deal with. And, if, you know, those aluminium plates are very light, and if they move them, and you sent a foreign person that he didn't know in his box, we might not get him on.
Right. What do you feel about the feel of the running of the race today? I mean, do you get a special mood about it? Is it different?
I tell you what, actually, you reckon there's 10,000 people here. I reckon you can multiply that by at least three.
Really?
It's heaving out there. You've been stood here all morning, and so you don't.
Well, not all morning. I've been here for about half an hour, Jenny. We don't stand here for hours, you know.
But. They're in real upbeat mood, and I reckon there'll be such a yell goes out from these people today, you'll think there's probably 60 or 70,000.
All right, that's great. It's
making... And I should be shouting for 10.
I bet you will be.
So can
it's
you
making
shout
a good
state. Well?
It's making a good statement to stage
it's
it today.
A very good
and
yeah. It had got to happen.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's
Jenny, we wish you luck and thank you for joining us once again. And let's hope it's a good day again.
Did you have any more thoughts about that chat we had on Saturday?
No, I think we've done. I think we've done enough about that, don't you? The Gurkhas are here today anyway. Probably to look after Jenny, I would have thought. Gurkhas. I don't know where they learn to play the bagpipes, really, do you? But Graham Bradley rides Los Dragoni. Now, what's your weekend been like? I know you went to watch Liverpool, because I went to watch Liverpool play yesterday, and so did you. You were strangely attired.
We were. You've never seen anything like it on Saturday night in the Adelphi Hotel.
Yeah.
All the boys in the breeches and boots and colours and everything. It was like a fancy dress party. I mean, what could we do? We had nothing else to do apart from get absolutely legless and enjoy it. And
because
we had a great night.
Did you? Because like all the people, you had to leave your gear here, didn't you? You just couldn't get your cars out, you couldn't get your belongings.
It was very disappointing, it was very chaotic. I thought the police did a great job, but we were all herded out onto the race course. Nobody had money, credit cards, telephones, shoes, clothes, anything. We were just marooned out there and we all had to go into Liverpool and make the best of it.
But you got looked after, did you?
We did. Everybody's rallied around and been fabulous. People were lending jackets and shirts and trousers and suits and things and lending each other money. And we just went out and had a good time, made the most of it.
You didn't bring Liverpool much luck yesterday, neither did I.
Unfortunately not. We met Robbie Fowler on the Thursday night, lovely guy, and he invited a few of the boys to come and watch the game. Unfortunately, they got beat, but again, that's football.
Yeah. What do you feel about the race today? Now, well, first of all, tell me about your chance, because we spoke on Saturday, and this is your 11th ride. You've ridden a lot of outsiders, haven't you, in those years? And you've got a chance today, haven't you, with Lester again?
He's got a little chance, yes. His last run at Haydock was very, very disappointing. But there was something wrong with him, we feel. He's got some very good form and on good ground as well. We think the ground's going to be too quick for him. But touch what he jumps, should get every yard of the trip and would have a little squeak.
OK. Now, I wonder if this boy's got a squeak. We spoke to him. This is Joe Tizard. You know him, of course. At 17, the youngest jockey. Now, how did you spend your day yesterday being rather busy? We were watching football. You were riding, weren't you?
Yeah, I was riding the local point-to-point near home.
Yeah. How'd you get on?
Well, I had three winners yesterday, so...
Just the three winners?
Yeah.
Well, that's good. I suppose it'd be quite good to keep busy, wouldn't it, yesterday, you know?
Well, yeah, I was going to do the point-to-point if the Grand National was run on Saturday or not, so... I mean, it's usual stuff for me.
How disappointed were you on Saturday? Your big day?
I was gutted, you know. I was all looking forward to it, ready to get out there and do the job, and then that had to happen, so yeah. Very disappointed.
And you feel more nervous now today, coming back a second time, or much the same, or what?
Well, much the same, just hopefully it'll go ahead and we can get on with it now.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, best of luck to you both, Graham Bradley, Joe Tizard. You ride straight to all, of course, and yeah. We hope that you have a good afternoon. Now we have a very important visitor once again. Princess Royal, Undaunted, has returned here. She was here on Saturday, of course, and she's returned to watch the Grand National being run here today. So that's Princess Anne, of course, a great horsewoman herself. And there she is with Peter Greenall, Lord Darsbury, enjoying the day, and we hope that you will enjoy it with us too. Sal, now let's look. I mean, Jenny Pittman's probably right. She's usually right about most things. I probably did underestimate perhaps the crowds that would be here today. And look, they're queuing to get in here. Of course, it's a free day. That might have something to do with it. But spectacular number of people queuing to get in to watch this race. So this Monday Grand National might yet have the sort of feel that normal Saturdays do here over the years. We thought it might be a little bit deserted. It looked that way early on. Now we've got, we're told one or two helicopters are coming in, and there may be one or two other VIP guests here. Let's just have a look at this picture, this live picture, just for a moment, and see who may emerge from this. I've heard one or two rumours about who may be here today. Well, the Prime Minister has arrived, it seems. So we might just see Mr. Major emerge. And I presume it's on the ground. I can't quite. Well, it is. So it's a VIP day here as well, and everybody's supporting the fact that the Grand National is going to be run here today after the traumas and futility of Saturday. Well, I expect we'll see a little bit more of Mr. Major in due course. But now let's hear from some of the other people who are here today.
I thought the organisation must be absolutely spot on, you know, really. And it's a shame, isn't it? Because I was with Tim Maloney, who had Red Rum before Ginger McCain had him. And I used to ride Red Rum when he was a two-year-old, when he was a seller. You know, he could only win selling races at a time. And as you know, Red Rum came on to be one of the best horses ever run in the National. So, you know, yes, we have got a great claim for the National. It should never be stopped by because of IRA or any problems.
Some bookmakers have left money in the hot.
What sort of sums are we talking about?
Well, I mean, one guy mentioned £2,000. Now, whether whether that's right or whether it's exaggerated, I wouldn't know that.
But you're a bookmaker. How much would you? What are the odds about that money still being in the hob now?
Well, if I wouldn't take 100-1 personally. I would think if there was £2,000 in a bookmaker's hob for what 48 hours nearly or so, I wouldn't have thought. I wouldn't have thought it would still be there. Would you? Would you take 100-1?
It hasn't deterred you from bringing the family today?
No, because we were only going shopping, and when we found out we could come in, we came in. It's the opportunity for us to come in.
And are you going to have a bet?
I've done three.
Go Ballistic, Sunny Bay and General Wolf.
So just to endorse, the Prime Minister is here present for the Grand National running today. I don't know how much of a race goer he normally is. He's certainly a cricket man and likes his football at Chelsea. Now we've got with us Rob Hartnett of the Tote organisation. What's happened to all the people who placed money with the Tote on Saturday?
What we've had to do, Dave, is we've had to void all of those bets that were placed on Saturday. Those race goers that have come here today have been able to claim their money in cash and place bets into the new pool. If you haven't been able to come here, and there will doubtless be many of you, there is an address on the back of every one of those Tote tickets, send off the receipt to there, and we will send you out the money.
We'll send them a cheque for the money.
We will.
Okay, so nobody loses. They only lose if they pick the wrong horse.
That's right.
But and what about the other? Because the tote system is rather different from some of the other bookmakers. What are the other bookmakers doing?
It is. Well, all of the other bookmakers, and most of you who are watching now, will have actually placed bets with the high street bookmakers. All of those bets will stand. If you've backed Jenny Pittman to win the national and you haven't gone back to cancel the bet, then good luck to you because your bet is on.
Right, but if you've gone back to cancel, they will repay just as the tote did.
That's right. There was an opportunity to refund earlier this morning, but I think the vast majority of people will be willing to let their bets run on.
How difficult an administrative thing is all this for you?
It's very difficult.
Yeah.
The most important thing is that the race is on now, and for all of the millions of people that have had a bet, you know, they're looking forward to watching the race and to see if they've backed the winner.
Tell me what happened on Saturday to all the cash that you have here. I mean, we all had to get out of here pretty quickly. Presumably you did and your staff did. Were they able to take the money with them?
We did. We had gathered at the control room, and most of the staff were told that whatever money they had in their tills at the moment, grab it, put it in your pockets, put it in your handbags, let's take it away from the race course. It took us an hour and a half, 2 hours to gather all the staff together and relieve them of that fair burden of carrying
all
the cash.
You got it all?
Oh, we got it all. They're very trustworthy. they did magnificently, the hotel.
And where do you think the money seems to be going today?
It looks as if it's going on Go Ballistic, but Sonny Bay had drifted out into betting. He's been well back so far today. So I think the money, again, it's the Grand National, is a huge spread.
Absolutely. Okay, well, thank you very much, Rob, and for explaining all that to us. I think it's now time to join Richard Pittman and Scoo for some more pre-race scenes.
Yes, of course, it's all starting to happen. The jockeys are starting to pull their hats on, but down here at the parade ring, the horses have been in for some time, but the public have only just been allowed up to the rails, and there was a surge of people to come and see the horses, Scoo.
Yes, there's a real great atmosphere amongst the racing people, though. We're meant to park down at a pub car park down the road, and everybody was in having a drink. A lot of the jockeys were coming into the bar there, not to have a drink, but to swap colours, because colours had been lost and got tangled up on Saturday, and they all were giving each other the colours. So if one or two jockeys come out in the wrong colours, you know why.
Right, well, that was the bookmakers, but down in the saddling boxes, Jonathan Powell is with Sue Bramwell, Antonin's trainer.
Yes, down here in the saddling boxes, Sue Bramwell's just putting the finishing touches to putting the saddle on Antonin, number 13. Sue, this is a horse that left here on Saturday night. How has the departure, going away for 2 days and bringing him back, has it worried him?
Not at all, no. He's fresh and bright, and he's been at home, he's been very laid back. He's eaten up, no problems at all, very happy with him.
Perhaps the humans involved with him are more nervous than the horse at this stage?
Probably, yes.
Are you worried about the faster ground for him?
No, not at all. No, the ground up there is fine.
You have a smashing run.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Yes, Antonin's lad is Derek Murphy, been with Sue for a while there. The horse, I saw him come out of his boxes, he looked well. What about Sonny Bay then? Well, there was some doubt about his participation with the ground drying up, Skew. Very relaxed. I just feel the turf here, the old black sedge, won't inconvenience him. Jamie Osborne rides, he's been round here five times before. 9-1 shot.
Yeah, you're right about the turf, and it's in great condition. We saw the grass on it on Thursday, and there was a real good cover of grass, best I've seen for a long time here, and I think it shouldn't harm any horse.
Phil Sharp, of course, leading him up. He was the hero of Saturday, staying hidden in there. But what about Glamotte, one of two runners from Kim Bailey's yard? Now, this horse, for my book, will not stay, but his lad Nick Stokes says I can apologize to him later. A horse that doesn't stay three can sometimes stay four and a half.
Yes, he was third in the Beecher's Chase round here in last November, and that's over 3 mile 3, so I wouldn't be too definite about him not staying, but I think he will be held up for a run at any rate.
Okay, well, we'll go out of the paddock and back to the saddling boxes. Jonathan.
Yes, we've moved on to one of the most popular greys in training, Dexter Dove. Simon Earle, his trainer, who used to ride him as a jockey in the early days. Simon's just completing the saddling. Simon, this is one of the few horses that stayed here on Saturday night through the chaos. Was it a problem for him?
Not at all. He's really enjoyed his stay. He's had a great time. He's been going off to... I took him off to Haydock for a gallop yesterday, and he had a lovely stroll around the racecourse here today. He's had a great time.
He actually looks very relaxed.
yeah, this is the great thing about this horse. You know, nothing would bother him at all. Nothing would bother him at all. In fact, all this commotion and all the goings on would improve him, if anything, you know.
A year ago, you missed out on the National at the last minute with a training problem. Did you think your chance had gone again on Saturday?
Well, I mean, yes. I was saying days before that how well everything had gone leading up to it. Everything had fallen into place. The ground had come. We got the right jockey. Everything had gone so well, I almost couldn't believe it. And then we're in here, and we put this saddle on here, and then we're told to go home. It was awful. But it's brilliant that we're here. It's brilliant.
Great to see you. Good luck to you.
Great. Thank you.
Yes, the grey hasn't won since 1961, Nicholas Silver. It's a long time. But these two greys today have an excellent chance. Things are starting to zing a bit now in the paddock, and all the jocks have spoken to have raised their game. Northern Lad, one of the biggest horses in the field. He's led up by Donna Wallace, and that's Jesse James, travelling head man on the far side. Lovely big horse. If only he could recapture that form of last year's skew, when of course he beat the Gold Cup winner, Mr. Mulligan.
Yes, as you know, it's pointless writing off any of Jenny Pittman's horses in the National. I remember Royal Athlete coming here with similar sort of form, being disappointing. She got him bouncing back and winning. He's 14-1, and as you say, Mr. Mulligan, the winner of the Gold Cup, defeated by this horse in the Sun Alliance Novice Chase at Cheltenham last year. More form like that, and he'll take a lot of beating today.
Well, the lads, as Jason Titley, having a look at what might be happening out there. He rides Northern Lad, of course, and he's also won this race and been unseated at the first fence in 1996.
You were very unlucky there, weren't you, though, Jason? Jason, put your thumb up.
John Buckingham going through the shot. Memories of Foynavin's year. Well, back to 13 now in the paddock. That is Anton, a horse we've already seen, but back to the saddling and Jonathan.
Yes, Gordon Richards is down here. He was just adjusting the boots on Buckball Bounce, and now he's hopefully going to put the saddle on. Excuse me one moment, madam. Gordon, you've got a problem with the boots here?
Really? Just making quite sure it's secure.
And for people at home watching this, why would a horse wear boots around his front legs?
I'm a great man. It's for the overreach. You know, if he just strikes into the tendon, that's the worst part of the horse, that you want any damage. So with all my horses throughout my life, I've always put a boot on them, and I think it's a great thing to save an overreach.
Gordon, this is a race you won twice. I know you're very keen to win it again. How pleased were you that the race is on again?
Well, very, very pleased, because, I mean, it had to go on, and I'm very proud and pleased of everybody, what they've done at Aintree. They've done a fantastic job, and we had to go ahead, because you mustn't be beaten by naughty people like that. I mean, you've got to go and beat them, and which is what Liverpool's done, and I'm so proud of them, because that's what I would do myself.
This horse is just starting to tremble. Is that nerves?
Well, he knows. He was here Saturday. I'd done the same thing like this, and he knows. And I mean, he was locked up in the stable, and he's gone home, and he's come back to Greystoke, but he's had a lovely weekend, and I think he's in lovely, fantastic condition, and he's ready for what he's going to do today.
Let's hope he comes home safe.
That's very kind.
Thank you, Gordon.
A pleasure. Thank you.
Well, what was a deserted paddock only 5 minutes ago, now they're 20 deep around it. People want to get up close and see the horses, but the place had to be made secure, and secure it certainly is. People are flocking in. This is a great sight, and funnily enough, a great opportunity for people who perhaps can't afford to come on a normal national day to get in and savour the action. Obviously, a lot of the boxes are empty today. It's easier to secure outside places, but we do have plenty of people. I think you'll find that the atmosphere will be hat-lifting. Just whoever wins today, it's going to be one of those nationals to savour and remember. So, a lot of the horses I've seen so far, very, very relaxed. This is the only mare in the race, Skew, and she's got her tongue tied down to help her breathing, but she stays forever.
Yeah, she's another one that'll be held up. I think she's got a really good chance of being placed at a long price. She's 33-1. I was down at Exeter with the Pipes earlier in the week, and she said that Mrs. Pipes said to me she really fancied this horse to run well. They were struggling to find a jockey for her, but they've got a very, very good rider, and there he is, Robbie Supple, with the black and white colours of the Pipe Racing Club.
Yes, and then Evangelica led up by Cheryl War. Cheryl, who really does think that this mare will go well today. So the jocks are getting tied up, ready to go out. It will only be a few minutes now before we see them come out, but Julian's down in the centre of it in the paddock.
Stan Clarke, the owner of Lord Gyllene, we're here at last. Have you still got your big party here?
Well, I'm relieved too that we are starting at last. Yes, we've got a party here, but it's not quite the same. The champagne isn't even in the box yet.
Well, keep it on ice when it gets there, anyway.
We certainly will.
Steve Brooks, you're the trainer. You had less far than anyone to go on Saturday night when you went home.
Well, I think one or two were home before me, but we were home very early. Half past eight, we were home anyway, so.
How did Lord Gyllene react to all the activity on Saturday?
She's very happy. He's eaten up, he's drunk, everything, so we're happy with himself at the moment anyway.
Any different scenario to Saturday, same plan?
Well, Jockey's got what he wants, knows what he wants to do, and so it's up to him now.
Good luck to you.
Thank you.
Here, Josh Gifford, the trainer of the Great Alden ET. This time you're carrying bottom weight with Spuffington, Josh. How's he been while you've been saddling him?
Well, I think it's an insult to a great trainer like me that I'm running 150 to one shot. He's not 150 to one shot. You tell mums and dads at home they can have their pound each way.
He jumps and he stays.
He jumps and he stays. He won't mind the ground. I'd like a little bit softer. I don't really know, to be honest, what trip he does want, but he's certainly not that big a price. You know, I mean, I honestly, genuinely think he's got an outside chance.
How thrilled are you that the race is on after the
event? Oh, what a fantastic turnout. What can you say? I mean, it's true British grit. And people have come from nowhere, you know, to come and see it. Even people like Barry Hills and Nicky Henderson hasn't got a runner. They've made the effort to come. I think he's fantastic.
Great to see you're part of it again.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
We'll see you in the winner's enclosure then.
So, as the horses are nearly all saddled now, it's a time to reflect on the current state of the market. Graham.
Go Ballistic is the one they've come for. He's clear favourite at 8-1. Then they go 9-1 Sunny Bay, 10-1 Lord Gyllene and Wild Hyde, 10 Zavro Anson, 12 to Gunnloads Goni, 14's Antonin, 14's Northern Lad and Smith's Band, that's Jenny Pittman's pair, 16 the well-backed outsider Feathered Gale, 16-1 General Wolf, 25-1 Master Oates.
Yes, the market hasn't altered all that much since Saturday, and the horses that are coming here in excellent fettle. Go Ballistic, fourth in the Cheltenham Gold Cup for Go Ballistic. He's got the class, his jumping has been questioned in the past. Susan Ruff's in charge of him. She thinks he'll get round, and it's the first runner in the race for trainer John O'Shea. Mick Fitzgerald, of course, no stranger to this because it's his third time round. He's a winner last year, and he also fell at the first fence.
Yes, he's a very decent horse. His fourth in the Gold Cup proves that. I mean, he's jumped very well throughout his career. It's only his second season as a steeplechaser. He's 8-1 favourite from 9-1, and he's looks fantastic.
Well, Mick Fitzgerald's very relaxed there, having a ciggy and a coke and whatever else. So down in the paddock, Julian's talking to more connections.
Charlie Brooks, the trainer of Sunny Bay. It's been another cliffhanger. When did you finally decide to run?
About an hour ago. I just wanted to talk to the owners to make sure they were happy. They've done a good job watering the course today. It was a really great effort. I had a hobble around and was pleasantly pleased to see my feet got very wet. It's not the best sort of ground for our horse, but I still think he'll run very well on it.
How did Sunny Bay spend the weekend?
He's had a great weekend. I think he's really loved every moment of it. He went to Haydock. We've been able to train there normally. And, you know, he's in great form.
Best of luck.
Thanks.
Thank you, John.
Now the jocks are starting to come out. Sunny Bay, ridden by Jamie Osborne. Autograph Hunters on the way out. It's a lovely feeling, Skew. But here in this narrow confine, they should be emerging any time now. Jamie Osborne had his white breeches on. They had red wine stains on this morning. But here they all come out. There's the stars of Franny Woods going through. Chris Bonner, he's got round twice. And, of course, Paul Carberry in the Ogden colours.
Yeah, it's always a difficult time for jockeys, this. They're trying to get their concentration together. The enthusiastic racegoers asking for autographs. It's not always the best time. There's Lorcan Wire just going through. Johnny Kavner, Andrew Thornton, Frankie Woods, Norman Williamson, Simon McNeil. They're all just filtering on through. Last bit of advice there from the valets crossing themselves. And there's Jason Titley. He knows his way how to win. There's Robert Thornton, his first ride. Chris Maud looking very serious. Conor O'Dwyer, Antonin.
Glenn Tormey there having his first ride as well.
Richard
Lots of people
Johnson.
Going for their first ride today. We've got a super lot. Now, here is Smith's Band's rider, Richard Dunwoody, with two wins to his credit already. He's a cool customer.
There's Mick Fitzgerald, just Timmy Murphy, who's got the mount on Dakin's boy.
Timmy, another one, having his first ride of the Grand National course, and that in itself is a very big occasion to anyone. There, of course, JP McManus's colours, Charlie Swan, having his seventh ride in the race. He's completed on five occasions. He fell at the first fence in 94.
In the paddock, Prime Minister, welcome. Your first visit to Aintree.
Well, it's some years since I've been here. I'm delighted to be here today and absolutely thrilled this race is being run.
You must feel terrifically pleased that it's all fallen into place and fantastic crowd here today.
Well, I just admire the courage and good humour of people on Saturday. The tremendous way that the people of Merseyside coped with all those thousands who had nowhere to go. I think it was a tremendous effort by Merseyside. But I think the whole British nation wished to see this race run. And it's a message not just that nobody can bomb Britain out of their national instincts and national habits. I think that's a message to the IRA and a clear message to the rest of the world as well.
What's the feedback you're getting from the crowd today?
Oh, they're a very buoyant, very friendly crowd. And I always enjoy large crowds like this, and I'm enjoying it today. They're very friendly.
Very quickly a winner.
Well, I'm very tempted, given the nature of life, to say go ballistic, but we'll have to see. Thank you, Julian.
Yes, that will be very topical in the saddest sense, but coincidence bets do win. There's Master Oates in front of us. Lovely big horse, isn't he? And, well, he's been here twice. He fell. He just didn't quite get the trip after the Gold Cup win, Skip.
Yeah, it came quick to him. But what's noting, he's got to pull up by his name. But if you remember last year at Chepstow, he pulled up in what looked an ordinary race, and then he came and ran a cracker in the King George when he finished behind one man. He would probably like softer ground, but he has jumped around here safely, and even with 11 stone 10 on his back, he can't be ruled out. His price is at now 25 to 1.
Yeah, Sean Ellis, who does him, has looked after this horse for 5 years now. He really is so close to the horse. 25 to 1, well, that could look value a bit later on. Norman Williamson, of course, a regular round here. But there are still others that we need to see, because this is such an open race. The colours there of John Manners, Sean Curran having his first ride in the race, but the jockeys are being dwarfed in there by the connections.
It's always a strange feeling, the paddock at Aintree, because of the number of people in here. You don't usually have so many onlookers in a paddock as you do at Haydock, and it's always very difficult to find your horse if you're a jockey sometimes.
Well, the bell's gone, people are walking towards their horses now, so the next stage in the 97 National is underway, and this is where the jockeys start to relax. All they want to do is to be with their horse alone to face whatever is in front of them. Here, just coming towards us, that's Paul Nichols on the right of the picture. His rider, of course, Joe Tizard, the youngest rider in the race today. Three winners point-to-pointing yesterday. He must absolutely be buzzing, I would imagine. But isn't it great to see this crowd here, Skew?
Yes, it is. It is a strange atmosphere, isn't it? But it's suddenly built up, as you see, the people have suddenly come into the race course, and a lot of enthusiasm for the rerunning of the race.
Well, there is Dan Fort in the orange and white diamonds there. He's riding Scribbler. Mickey Harris is leading the horse up. He said that the blinker's off, he should relax a bit. So people queuing up, they're so deep there. Of course, everybody has got to be searched before coming in, and safety is paramount. So I just hope they can all get in 20 minutes time for the start of the Martel Grand National. Just looking down at the horses there. I haven't seen one yet getting overheated or overexcited. There is eight. This is Buckboard Bounce, of course, Robert Ogden's famous colours. Now, this horse has been pinpointed as Robert and Gordon Richards' national horse for some time. Well, his form just doesn't quite tell us that at the moment. It's Paul Carberry's third ride in the race. He finished sixth in 1996. And if he hadn't been fit, remember he'd hurt himself, he was on crutches only a week ago. Well, Captain Captain Adam Ogden would have been riding this horse in his place, and I don't think he'd have quite been riding as short as that.
No, he's a terrific rider, Paul Carberry, rides across country regularly on a Sunday. He's been one of the finest finds as a jockey for a long time. Unusual preparation for this horse in that he ran over hurdles last time.
Well, there's some colours we know well. Celtic Abbeys, of course. Now, Richard Johnson was always going to ride this one, but Brendan Powell was going to ride, but if Johnson became available, it was always going to be his ride. But sad for Brendan.
Yes, Venetian Williams trains in Hereford. Richard Johnson himself is a Hereford boy, so there's a connection there. His price is 66 to 1.
Well, they're on their way out. Now, that's Chris Bonner. Chris riding Pink Gin. Margaret Francis colours, and Zoe Hewitt is in charge of this one. I spoke to her earlier and she thought that this could surprise a few people, and it's Chris's third ride he's got round and been placed the twice he's ridden.
Yes, this horse has won over the 4 miles, so there would be no doubt about him getting the distance.
Oh, and of course Mickey Hammond has another runner in Valiant Warrior, but Chris is the Aintree jockey. Well, you can hear the crowds, they'll cheer every horse. They're all just pleased to be here today. As they come towards us, led, as ever, by the police, the mounted police. We've got Chris, who will be on number 39. He is on 39, Pink Gin, 201 shot. There's Mickey Hammond, the trainer, former jockey Mickey. And it'll be a big moment for him. Midland trainer, great place to train. Well, the famous colours there, the yellow and the black hoop, of course, and Duchess of Westminster on Royal Mandate. Yeah,
they've won the Grand National with Last Suspect. Coming through is the Irish-trained Antonin. I went across and saw him not so long ago in Ireland. He looked fantastic. There is Jamie Osborne just having a chat to somebody leading up, a broad grin across his face. Chris Maud, another grey, Dexter Dove. Spuffington, Josh told us all about him. The young man, Joe Tizard, riding Straight Talk, concentrating hard.
Well, back to the head of proceedings. We've got Pink Gin still leading them out, but they will, of course, once they're on the course, get into some sort of order. Jason Titley just getting his britches right. Everything is just right. You've got to feel comfortable in yourself.
Yes, all the jockeys will be trying to concentrate now. They'll have been very, very nervous. It's been a long build-up for them, but once you're on the horse, you begin to calm down a little bit. There'll be a few shouts from the Liverpool crowd here. It's always a different atmosphere from the Liverpool people. They're always prepared for a joke, and you don't know whether to answer them or not.
Jim Cullity going through, having his first ride. But you can see from the mix of faces, there's Tony Dobbin. Very serious. Now, Oz was smiling when he came out. Norman Williamson on the bouncing Master Oaks there. Well, he looks in excellent fettle.
Yes, it's the atmosphere sort of makes the people that talk a lot go silent, and the people that are silent talk a lot. It's wandering onto the course now, Andrew Thornton. You can see the visors of Riverman. That you can just see the gap between, just allows him to see a little bit. The whole build-up's coming now. They'll circle around here as the rest of the horses come in to the course, getting ready for the parade. A bit of an annoying time now for the jockeys, but you're just wanting to get on with the race itself.
But look at Woody, really laughing and joking there. It just does show age and experience against new experiences for young jockeys. Plenty of first-time outers, and the whole procedure is different for them. Straight Talk going through. There's Paul Nichols, the trainer. He'll be trying his own horse's girths out there. Everything is so important. Well, Mark Richards is behind Peter Niven there, two of the senior riders.
That's right, Peter Niven, as you just was having a smile there. I think the way that you are, the horse senses if you're nervous, the horse senses that. So you've got to, without being stupid, you as a jockey, you're trying to instill a little bit of confidence into the horse.
And of course, we saw there Mark Richards, he's on a horse that's fallen twice from two runs here at the very first fence.
Yes, Johnny Kavanagh riding for David Nicholson. David is a real stickler for orders, telling him exactly how he wants the horse ridden. Charlie Swan just wandering through.
So we're nearly set for the race, even the sun has come out, and Peter O'Sullivan's ready. Peter, you had to wait a little longer for your 50th Grand National commentary.
Yes, Des, but what a day it is. I'm fully sharing the general emotion and excitement. I wouldn't have believed that rather than a Monday, a delayed race like this, the atmosphere could have been so electric. It was just as normal in the weighing room. Atmosphere of enormous excitement and anticipation, and it's great that it's taking place, and it just shows that it's very difficult to deter the Scousers.
Indeed. Good luck, Peter. And of course, aiding and abetting Peter in his commentary today, as ever on the Grand National, is John Hanmer, who's out at fence number three, and the racing correspondent of the Daily Telegraph, Jim McGrath, who's down at the beaches there. Jim, who did such a valiant job for us here on Saturday. Now, let's go back to Richard for the moment for the parade.
I think the jockeys have done particularly well to sweat off. We got a few overweights, but so many are lumped down on the 10-stone mark. And after the frappar of the weekend, to continue the wasting and keep your game up, Skew, is very difficult.
Yeah, the advantage that the race has given the jockeys being run at 5 o'clock is that they've had all day to gradually get the weight off. Sometimes when you've got racing before and you can't get in the sauna, you're concentrating on something else. Today has given the opportunity of concentrating on the big race.
Well, what a shot there of the crowd, really packed in now. The atmosphere, well, I don't think it'll be so far away, apart from those country shots, of course, where people are. Drift through is Dan Fort there having his first ride, and riders now testing their girths. David Walsh on Grange Break.
He obviously had a good weekend because he's put up four pound overweight, and he's smaller than you are, Richard. That's in height, not in width.
Now, this is a time when the boys, they're out on the course. All they want to do now is be let loose, even from the lads whose horses they are. They look after them day in, day out. But the jocks want to take charge of their own horses now. Well, coming towards us, JP McManus's colours there, Charlie Swan.
World Hyde will be right up there with the pace. I think Master Oates, last time he went round, he gave him a bit of room, Norman, so he'll be looking for a bit of room towards the outside. Newark, there'll be a few people trying to avoid him. He doesn't jump very well. Conor Edouard and Antonin wandering through. Number 15 there is Newco. Mouse Morris thinks he's a very overrated in price for what he's done. He's finished in front of some of the well-fancied Irish horses.
Just Mark going Richards. Through Mark Richards. What a something facing him today, because having fallen twice at the first, Bishop's Hall in actual fact is a very good jumper. He's got a lot of power in his quarters, and that may be just why he ejects. All
there will be two horses that the jockeys will be avoiding all the race, or at least early, and that will be Bishop's Hall. Nobody will be wanting to track him early, and nobody will be wanting to track Newer.
Well, Joe Tizard, three winners yesterday, point-to-pointing. Straight Talk getting warm now. This is a long parade. Big build-up, but Joe looks cool.
Yeah, watch this horse. He's a real extravagant jumper, and he could give this young man a great ride.
Vice versa, I think the boy will give the horse a great ride, too. So, Master Oaks, 25-1 shot, class horse of the race. He carries an 11 stone, 10 pounds, Norman Williamson. Now Then Lad, owned by Pearl Hemmings. Jason Titley's a winner and also a faller at the first fence in 96, 14-1 shot. After him, we've got Lo Stregoni, would have been favourite or very nearly last year, just wasn't quite right. Brad, to seasoned performer, 14-1, another class horse. Following him, the first of the two greys in Sunny Bay from Uplands Bloodstock. Phil Sharp, his lad on the far side, was the hero on Saturday. Oz, not smiling now. Yes, he is. He'll be joking to the off. After him, very similar colours, but a different colour horse. And this is Feathered Gale from Franny Woods on board. Arthur Moore, one of his three runners in this race. Following him, these are the colours of Afro Anson, Peter Niven, Morris Camacho. Morris owns a quarter in this horse, and Peter Niven is an experienced campaigner at 12-1 at the moment. Buckboard Bounce from Robert Ogden, Paul Carberry, run of the shortest stirrup riders in the race. Gordon Richards trains 33-1. for the horse from Penrith. And then the one that's fallen at the first fence twice, and he's only two runs here, Bishop's Hall. He's a 50-1 shot. What price for him to get round? Mark Richards, the job. Lord Gyllene, a horse that stays this trip. Tony Dobbin on board. His second ride, he was unseated in 96 at the third fence, 12-1 at the moment. Wild High, there's been fortunes on this horse. A very big, handsome horse in the colours of J.P. McManus. Another from the Arthur Moore stable. Following him, we've got the next and the second of the greys, Dexter Dove. Again, if he's all right, he's had a lot of problems. He's got a little bit of class, 33-1, Chris Moore. Antonin from Ireland, used to be trained here, of course. Sue Bramwell now in Wexford. He's 12-1, he's not very big, but Sue says the 2 days interim have perked him up. Smith's Band, Jenny Pittman's second runner in the Arthur Smith colours. Well, this one is carrying £2 overweight for Dunwoody. He has worked wonders to get there, 14-1. After that, we've got the colours of Newco in Anne Daly's colours. She's had, this is her fourth runner. They've all got round, 40-1 shot. And this one for Mouse Morris, David Casey having his first ride. After him, of course, Go Ballistic. Again, fourth in the Gold Cup. That is class. Will he jump, though? Following him, General Wolf, Lorcan Wire on board, his third run in the race. After that, the Glamotte colours of Dennis Yardy, Kim Bailey's only second runner. It's his fifth time for Simon McNeil. And then, of course, the star of Valiant Warrior, Russ Garrity, having his first. And here, well, is a happy face. It's Terry Mitchell, and he's having his first ride on New App. Not a safe jumper. After him, the blue Northern Hyde, Taffy Salomons. Paul Holly is on board here, having his fourth ride. So they're all, nearly all, on the way down to the start. They're still breaking away here as we pick them up. The black and white there of Evangelica, the only mare in the race, Robbie Supple. Well, he's had a few chances. What about Dakin's Boy and Timmy Murphy? The diamonds of Dan Ford on Scribbler. The blinkers off today, and then Celtic Abbey, Richard Johnson replacing Brendan Powell. The red hat of Jim Cullity having his first ride. And they still go. There's Magoni Beach. Now, I would like him to win for personal reasons. The V of Don't Light Up, Robert Thornton, had two winners at the meeting already. And there, Spuffington, Julian Kloppert's colours, number 40, last but not least, Philip Hyde having his third ride in this great race. Well, let's catch up with the market as the horses head to the first to inspect it.
And Go Ballistic is developing as the gambler of the race, now down to 7-1. All the major firms back him on the course trying to offload their liabilities. Sunny Bay is 9-1. Wild Hyde back to win $750,000 in a few bets. He's 10-1. Lord Gyllene drifting up to 12s along with Avro Anson. Antonin went to 14, now back to 12-1. Low Stragoni, Smith's Band, both 14-1, along with Northern Lad. Feathered Gale is 16-1, and that's followed by General Wolf on 16s. Master Oates and Turning Tricks, 25-1, along with Evangelica. Look at this well-backed outsider. Buckboard Bounce, 33-1, along with Dextra Dove and Killishin. Full of Oates, 66-1, right down to 33-1. Newco is 40-1, and it's 50-1 bar.
Yes, and the jockeys just having a look at the first, and just tell you the overweight, Avro Anson, Peter Niven, he's put £1 overweight at 10 stone 3. Number 14, Smith's Band, Richard Dunwoody, he's down to his minimum weight, but that is £2 overweight at 10 stone 2. Number 16, Go Ballistic, Fitzgerald, who's worked very hard to get his weight down to 10-3, but that's £3 overweight. Valiant Warrior, number 19, Russ Garrity, is 10-3, £3 overweight. Number 22, Straight Talk, Mr. Joe Tizard, a very tall man, 10 stone 3 at £3 overweight. Northern Hyde, Paul Holly, 10 stone 1, £1 overweight. Number 26, River Mandate, Andrew Thornton, 10-1, £1 overweight. Number 27, Grange Break, David Walsh, he's had a good weekend, 10 stone 4, £4 overweight. Number 31, Scribbler, Danforth, 10 stone 2, £2 overweight. And last, number 40, Philip Hyde, 10 stone 2, £2 overweight, another very tall man.
So Jerry Scott just getting under the rails there. Behind him was Simon Morant, of course, who's the senior starter. Jerry, though, was a previous winner of this race as a jockey on Merriman. So the jockeys can see themselves on the big screen, but now, of course, this is when they feel happiest. They will have got their minds tunnel visioned here, Stu, as to exactly where they're going to line up, inner, middle or outer.
Yes, the ones down the inner will be the more experienced horses. Something like Go Ballistic here, Mick Fitzgerald says he's going to go towards the outer. He hasn't had a lot of experience over fences, this horse, but he's probably the best horse in the race. If he gets a good run and jumps well, he'll take all the beating. Something like River Mandate, who jumps a little bit left-hand and under Andrew Thornton, will have to go down the inside, otherwise he'll be getting himself in trouble from the other runners.
Yes, the two greys, of course, Dexter Dove and Sunny Bay. Can it be another grey winner since 1961? They have not had a success, but it can come. They're really starting to now keep away, Skip. We've seen people get unseated here before the start. Let's hope it doesn't happen today. Graham's got news of the betting.
Go Ballistic, still the clear favourite here in the ring at 7-1. Sunny Bay, look at that, 8-1 from 9-1. Then it's 10's Wild Hyde, 12 Lord Gyllene, Avro Anson, Antonin. Losgoni is 14-1, together with Smith's Band and Northern Lad, 16-1 bar.
And the drifter there, of course, is Lord Gyllene. There he is in the centre of the picture. This is a horse that has all the credentials. He's getting warm now, and this has been my long-term fancy, Stu.
Of all the runners, we've seen him in the paddock. They look fantastic wandering around. Is he the one that you fancy more than anything?
Absolutely. I think he's got all the credentials. Jumps right, stays right, goes on the ground. Be a great win for young Steve Brookshaw, whose uncle rode around here in Wyambrough with no stirrups for 2.5 miles. There is 6 going across. Avro Anson, he goes on the ground. Peter Niven on board. Well, the people have been queuing to get in, and this is the result. Hats off to Aintree, the Merseyside police, and everyone involved, because that crowd will give the winner of the 97 Martashnal some liftoff. Well, here they are, down at the start. We're not so very far away from the off time. The jockeys will over and over in their mind be eyeing up people beside them, moving away from people they don't want to line up against.
No, there's my idea in the winner, Richard, so we just have we can compare notes afterwards. Number 13, Antonin, I think he's the one they all have to beat. I'd prefer to see softer ground for him. I've got a great deal of respect for your tip, Lord Gyllene, but I'm going to go for him, Antonin.
So most of the horses are actually together, but Master Oates has been isolated from the group. And we've got one rider actually off at the moment to the left of the picture. I can't quite pick up the reason why that horse has been dismounted, but Simon Morant is asking them if they're okay. Master Oates, they're just looking now to see if the horse is all right. The vet is having a look. So there's reasons here to see if the horse, I think he must be bleeding. He looked at his hand there.
It's always a very, very dangerous time for horses. This is the unfortunate time for jockeys. It's one of the most dangerous times. The horses are het up and they can just lash out and cut you. You know, the adrenaline will be running through him. You can just see a little bit of blood above his near fall there. It's a very, very worrying time for jockeys. Very annoying. I mean, it's always the jockey's fault if you get kicked. I know it's a hard thing to say, but it's a thing that you should always be aware of and try and be careful.
Well, the reins are going back over his head. Norman's going to get the leg up. The horse trotted up sound there, so a drama beforehand. Well, that looks as if it had been averted. Tracy Bailey up in the stands, of course, was so associated with Mr. Frisk when he won the race. Let's go over to the man who will be calling his 50th and final Grand National, Peter O'Sullivan.
He's very disturbed, this horse, Master Oates. He's still got to join the others. He's got very stirred up, but he's jogging up now towards the other 35. And it shouldn't be long now before the 150th Martel Grand National is underway. Simon Morant consults his watch there. He's calling him in. This is his third start of the National. And the winners of 265 races lining up,
don't get onto the gate.
Being told not to get on the tape.
Take it back.
Killishin right the towards the near side. Go ballistic about six from the far side. The favourite Dexter Dubs right over on the far side with buckboard bounce. And also Nuaf. Glamont has got to get into line. He's just a little bit behind the other. So's Feathered Gale. And so's Newco, but that's it. And Newco dwells a little bit. Go ballistic is quite slowly away. Dexter Dub the grey on the wide outside is one of the early leaders with another grey Sunny Boy towards the near side. Northern Laswell up with them, and so's Los Dragoni and the mare Evangelica. Lord Gyllene also right up with them, and as they race towards the first, it's Sunny Bay, Lord Gyllene, and over on the far side, Dexter Dove, and over to John Hanmer.
And Sunny Bay on the near side, and Lord Gyllene took it together from Smith's man. Dexter Dove made a mistake, and Fuller Votes is a faller at the first, and I can't see any other fallers unless they come to the second. It's Smith's man in the lead from Lord Gyllene. Then in third place is Sunny Bay as they come towards the big ditch, the third fence. Lord Gyllene on the near side and Smith's band on the far side. Then Sunny Bay comes next, then comes Northern Lad. Out in the middle is Mugoni Beach with Dexter Dove. Wild Hides right up amongst them. Only one four at the first three fences. They jump the fourth, here's Jim McGrath.
And it's Lord Gyllene who led over the fourth from Sunny Bay, the grey on the near side. Northern Hide is up there and Smith's band is out very wide. Mugoni Beach just behind them in company there over on the far side with Dexter Dove as they come to the fifth in the Monday National. And it's Smith's band out very wide. Lord Gyllene the near side. All the leaders got over it. They're all over safely as they run down towards Beaches Brook the first time. It's Lord Gyllene on the near side from Smith's band. Just behind them is Dexter Dove, very wide. Northern Hyde is there in the centre. Spuffington there as well. Mugoni Beach just behind them as they clear Beaches. Sunny Bay on the near side. All the leaders got over it well. In fact, they're all over Beaches again. As they race down towards the Foinaven fence, it's Lord Gyllene, the leader from Sunny Bay. Then Smith's band and Northern Hyde behind them. Northern Lad with Wild Hyde and Sally. All back in the field. Back bar is gone. Back bar's a faller and Glamont has unseated his rider. Running down towards the canal turn now, and it's Lord Gyllene who leads them from Smith's band. In third place is Sunny Bay from Northern Hyde and Northern Lad. Wild Hyde is behind them from out very wide Celtic Abbey. As they got over that one, the leaders in good style. Well back in the field then on the inside is Avro Anson as they run down towards Valentine's. Further back is Dexter Dove. Then Master Oates in company with Mugoni Beach, Evangelica, Grange Break from Spuffington. Buckboard bounce back in the field as they head towards the next fence. We rejoin John Hanmer.
And Lord Gyllene took it just in front of Smith's band. In third place is Sunny Bay. Then Northern Hyde and Dexter Dove and Wild Hyde. And also Nuaf up with them as they jump the next open ditch. And there's one gone at that one. And the leader is Lord Gyllene from Smith's band. Then in third place is Sunny Bay. Four is Northern Hyde. It looks as if it was Killishin who went there as they jumped the next. And Lord Gyllene, the leader from Smith's band. Then Sunny Bay, third, Wild Hyde, four, Northern Hyde, five. Then on the outside, Celtic Abbey making ground ahead of Northern Lad. They're followed in next place by Dexter Dove and Buckboard Bounce at Mugoni Beach as we join Peter O'Sullivan.
And Lord Gyllene, who's been right in the van from the very beginning under Tony Dobbin, in the lead as they round this turn and make their way towards the 13th of the 30 fences. Lord Gyllene from Smith's band towards the outside, running strongly. Just in behind them comes Sunny Bay. Wild Hyde is close as well, and so's Northern Hyde. And then comes Celtic Abbey, and still wide of the field, the grey Dexter Dove over that one. And it was still Lord Gyllene, the leader. Very mistake there by Wild Hyde, and lost a lot of ground in the process. And is Charlie Swan going to get back? It doesn't look so. He could get back into the saddle over this one. And it's Lord Gyllene, the leader, from on the near side. Smith's band, then comes Sunny Bay. Straight Chalk was a faller there, ridden by the youngest rider, Joe Tizard. And as they come to the chair now, it's Lord Gyllene, the leader, from on the near side, Smith's band. Then comes Sunny Bay and Wild Hyde, then Northern Lad, and backboard bounce. Celtic Abbey was a faller with the chair. And as they come down now towards the water, it's Lord Gyllene, who's very nearly carried out there, Lord Gyllene, but he's
continuing all right. It's Lord Gyllene on the inside of Smith's Band. Then comes Sunny Bay. Then on the outside is Northern Hyde. On the inside is Northern Lad. Just in behind Northern Lad is Avro Anson. Behind Avro Anson, Buckboard Buns, and then Dextra Dub, and then Valiant Warrior. Then comes Master Rhodes. Behind Master Rhodes is Bishop's Hall. But it's Lord Gyllene the leader. Lord Gyllene from Sunny Bay on the inside towards the outer is Northern Hyde with Smith's Band, and then comes Northern Lad. Lord Gyllene the leader from a bothersome new loose horse as we rejoin John Hanmer.
And Lord Gyllene from Smith's Band, then Northern Hyde, Sunny Bay on the inside, then Avro Anson and Dextra Dub on the outside. Bishop's Hall's not far behind. They've got a lot further than in previous years. They're all streaming over that with the back marker Feathered Gale. Meanwhile, over the 18th, Lord Gyllene over first from Smith's Band, then Sunny Bay, Northern High, Dextra Dove, Northern Lad, Valiant Warrior, Avro Anson and Master Oates as they jump the 19th, the open ditch, and it's Lord Gyllene in front of Smith's Band, Sunny Bay, then on the inside, Northern Lad, Northern High, Valiant Warrior, Avro Anson, and then comes Dextra Dove, Master Oates and Bishop's Hall as we join Julian Jim McGrath.
Smith's Band was a faller. Smith's Band was a faller there at the 20th. The leader's got over it okay now. They're continuing on. Lord Gyllene, the leader, as they come to the 21st in the National. From in second place, there's Sunny Bay, the grey. Then now the lad from Avro Anson running a big race. Master Oates behind them. Then followed just behind the Valiant Warrior from Northern High. Dextra Dove's under the whip for the backers. At this stage, Buckboard mounts as they run down towards Beaches the second time. Lord Gyllene, the leader, to Beaches, with a loose horse preceding him, followed by Sunny Bay. Avro Anson jumped in third. Just behind them is now the lad, Master Oates, and then out very deep is Valiant Warrior as they went down towards the Foynaven fence. Buffington's gone. Back in the field is Buckboard Bounce, followed. Wild Hyde is gone as well. Back in the field too is Northern Hyde in company with Bishop's Hall, a long way from them, from Dextra Dove. Then Go Ballistic getting reminders well out of it with 20 lengths to make up from Camelot Knight. Then Evangelica as the leaders go to the canal turn. Back in the field is Killishin from Dakin's Boy. They're followed next in the field by Newco, and then well back is Turning Tricks from Anton, who's a mile behind him as the leaders go to Valentine's. Lord Gyllene still out in front. The back markers here are Grange Break at this stage, as we see General Wolf well out of it as well, and Pink Gin as they go to the next. We rejoin John Hanmer.
Go Ballistic very nearly went to Valentine's. He's a long way back, but in the meanwhile up front it's Lord Gyllene from Sunny Bay. Then comes Master Oates, followed by Valiant Warrior, Avro Anson. They're clear of Bishop's Hall. Last ditch, four out. Lord Gyllene, the leader. Sunny Bay very nearly went. Avro Anson, a mistake too. He looks tired. But going to the third last, it's Lord Gyllene from Sunny Bay. Master Oates, Valiant Warrior, Avro Anson, Buckboard Bounce, Bishop's Hall. As over the third last, it's Lord Gyllene, the leader, from Master Oates in second. Then Sunny Bay is third, Valiant Warrior four. Then Avro Anson, Buckboard Bounce, Bishop's Hall. They're followed by Northern Lad and Camelot Knight. And then comes Northern Hyde. But Lord Gyllene making a gallant effort to lead throughout as they go to the second last, and we join Peter O'Sullivan.
And it's Lord Gyllene about six lengths clear with 4.5 furlongs to run and two fences left to jump. Lord Gyllene, who's been right up there from the outset, being chased by the top weight Master Oates. Sunny Bay back in third place. Fourth is Valiant Warrior. Buckboard Bounce comes next. And they're running down now towards the second last fence in the National. It's Lord Gyllene well clear. Here's Prick coming to it. Jumps it well. Sunny Bay jumps in second. Master Oates jumps in third. Valiant Warrior four and five. Buckboard Dance coming now to the final fence in the National. And it's Lord Gyllene and Tony Dobbin clear. Lord Gyllene jumps it brilliantly as though he'd only just started the race. Sunny Bay jumps in second and Master Oates third. Then came Valiant Warrior and Buckboard Bounce, and behind them is Camelot Knight, but racing towards the elbow, and Lord Gyllene is sprinting away with the 1997 150th National. A fantastic performance of jumping this by Lord Gyllene, getting a tremendous reception from the crowd. A terrific performance this. Lord Gyllene carries the colours of Stanley Clarke to victory. Lord Gyllene is the winner of the 1997 National. Sunny Bay runs on gallantly to be second. It's close for third, with Camelot Knight getting up to be third, but Ford Bounce four. Five was the top weight Master Oates, six was Avro Anson, seven was Killishin, and behind them came Dakin's Boy, and behind Dakin's Boy was Northern Laird, and then Valiant Warrior and Antonin and Northern Hyde, and then Turning Tricks and Pink Gin, and then Newco, and what an amazing amount of finishers there are too. Then General Wolf, Go Ballistic, and so Lord Gyllene, number 10, is the winner of the 1997 National, owned by Mr. Stan Clarke, trained by Steve Brookshaw, and ridden by 24-year-old Tony Dobbin on his second ride in the National. Second was number 4, Sunny Bay, owned by Andrew Cohen of Upland's Bloodstock, trained by Charlie Books and ridden by Jamie Osborne, 14-1 the winner. And third was Camelot Knight, number 34, owned by Mr. Michael Gates, trained by Nigel Tristan Davis, and ridden by Carl Llewellyn. And fourth, Buckboard Bounce. But this is the winner, Lord Gyllene. Stan Clarke, the owner of Uttoxeter and Newcastle, has been a long-time supporter of the Brookshaw family. That was Steve Brookshaw. That is Steve Brookshaw with his horse now. A marvelous result for him. This New Zealand horse, who went to post, winner of 3 of his 10 races, and of an aggregate with aggregate earnings of 55,000, which he's increased this afternoon by 134,000, and that is the owner's prize money. A tremendous outcome for New Zealand breds, this, and an absolutely sparkling performance by this jumper, who was previously a very significant winner at the owner's own course at Uttoxeter. And Stan Clarke leads in the winner of the 1997 Martel Grand National. A fantastic second ride in the race for 24-year-old Tony Dobbin. And he's really finished like a fresh horse, this. Absolutely sparkling effort, a joyous Stan Clarke there, being photographed with this spectacular horse of his, being congratulated there by Gordon Richards, whose Buckboard Bounce ran a very honorable race indeed. Lord Gyllene, the 14-1 winner of the first Monday National. Second was Sunny Bay at 8-1. Third was Camelot Knight, 100-1. And fourth, Buckboard Bounce at 40-1. The happy entourage with the hero of the hour, Lord Gyllene by Ring the Bell, out of Dentel, both sire and dam, bred in his home country, New Zealand. Tony Dobbin returns to weigh in after a memorable ride which will live forever in his memory.
Well, wonderful moments here, and this is Steve Brookshaw, the trainer. The horse virtually led from start to finish. That was a remarkable feat.
Well, we know he stays. He's won it over 4.25 miles before, so there was no point hanging back, so we had to go for it.
Was that the instruction, just...
No instructions, jockey made his own mind up, so...
The jockey did the business for you, absolutely. Yeah, he gave it a great ride, Tony Dobbin,
great ride, yes.
Didn't he? Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit more about the horse and about your preparation for the race, then.
horses running the last two races have both been over 4 1/4 mile. He got beat the last time. He was carrying top weight. Today he's carried 20-something pound less than he's ever carried before, so we decided to go for it.
So, and you really fancied your chances for this,
we thought
you?
He was in a very good chance, as long as he jumped round.
Yeah. Now, your family's got a background in this race.
Well, Uncle Tim missed to win the National. His leather broke. Michael Scudamore won it. Yeah. Perhaps he would have won it anyway, but his
that
leather
broke.
That
was when Oxo won it, and he was your uncle was riding Winbro, wasn't he? Right, right. There's the man. Tony Dobbin, you gave that horse a wonderful ride.
Well, he gave me a wonderful ride. He's brilliant.
Yeah.
He was jumping from fence to fence, had a little scare. Come out of stands here with a loose one, but yeah. Brilliant.
Come in here a little bit. We'll see you a bit better. We want the public to see you. This historic Grand National, a Monday Grand National.
Yeah. I mean, you would have thought that wouldn't be the same atmosphere and all that, but for me, it's better. I can't believe it.
Well, early on, it didn't look like there'd be big crowds, but the crowds have been fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you had one little scare.
Yeah, just a loose one coming by the stands.
Yeah.
Only for that, he was brilliant. He measured fences himself and he was fabulous. Brilliant.
Tony, you get those moments over the last and you think now, well, this is the difficult bit, you know, that last running, but you didn't have any problems there.
Well, across the Mellon Road, he was ailing a bit on me. You know, he's pricking his ears. He's that sort of horse, like.
Yeah.
And I didn't know how far clear it was, but I wasn't stopping on him. You know, I was wanting to keep him going because he is a big idle horse, like.
A big idle horse.
He just kept going. Brilliant.
Yeah, yeah. Had you ridden the horse much before?
I've ridden three times this year and won on him once.
Yeah, and that was at your Toxeter, yes. Yeah. And your record in the National, I think this is, what, only your second ride in it, isn't it?
Yeah, I fell off at the third and before. I've missed the last two Nationals through injury, like.
Yeah, right.
But I've had a couple of winners over the Aintree fences before, you know, I won the Beecher Chase this year and I won a 2 mile chase one day.
So did you enjoy it?
Brilliant. Unbelievable, yeah. I just can't believe it.
Yeah, last year's winning jockey said it was better than sex. You got any special quotes?
I'm not going to say that because my girlfriend's there and I'm not going through the same as Mick Fitz did.
Well, it was terrific. Well done. Many, many congratulations.
Thank you.
I think because of the nature of it, because it's held on Monday and because of all that happened on Saturday, it'll go down in Grand National folklore perhaps more than it otherwise would have done.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Right. Now, this is Stan Clarke, the owner. Now, Mr. Clarke, you're a racing man, aren't you? Because you're chairman of Utoxeter and chairman of Newcastle.
That's right,
you?
Indeed, I am. Yes.
Yeah. So, but this is a special day.
Oh, the
come this way a little bit so we can see a bit better. Turn around to the camera there.
Aintree has all the magic that can be in racing, and to come here and compete in the National is a wonderful opportunity, and has all the magic. But to come out here with a young horse that I bought from New Zealand off a video. I think it's so exciting and wonderful. No, it is a great day for me and everybody.
You bought the horse by seeing it on video?
That's right.
Yeah.
I buy horses from New Zealand on a fairly regular basis. I watch the videos and...
That one looks useful.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. And I take a risk. I pay for them before they leave, including the transport and the vet.
Yeah.
And if they land, they're going to be okay.
Yeah.
But it's great news. Steve Brookshaw, young trainer.
Yes.
He's trained Hunter Chase and Point to Points for us for 12 years and in 8 years of that time, he trained as 43 winners. And then I persuaded him to take a full license last year. I had 6 winners and a few horses. This year he's had 12. This is 13th winner. And he said to us, what are you going to run on Monday? He said, this horse is like a real Kiwi. He could play rugby if you asked him to. And here we are,
strong.
Winning the National. Strong.
Yeah.
But no, he's a big athletic horse. And he could dance around a bit, and so delighted. For me, he didn't make a mistake, but Tony would know about that.
Tony said he was a bit worried about a loose horse.
Oh, yes. Almost pushed him out from the grandstands.
Yeah. Now, this is your daughter coming in here, and your granddaughter,
my
I
granddaughter,
believe.
Sally.
Okay.
Lived in Liverpool until recently, and Georgina here.
Georgina, yeah. Georgina's 4. Did you? Oh, you got worked up during that race.
I certainly did. I've never felt so frightened in my life.
Yeah, yeah.
Georgina was very calm.
Well, did you enjoy the race, Georgina?
Yes.
Well, I think
she wore our colours today, you see, Desmond.
Right. Special.
It's been a great.
Now we've got we've got a picture on the monitor here for you to look at.
Yeah.
Now who's this going bonkers here?
No idea, not me.
Oh.
That's what we felt like. If you'd taken one of me, I'd have been like that. In actual fact.
Well, he's clearly a man who's had a lot of money on it.
Yeah, he's better looking than me as well.
He's a chap who's had.
Yeah.
Oh, he's a pal. Might be a pal of Mr. Brookshaw, Steve Brookshaw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. He's a wonderful young man, you know. Young man, second season. He trained Rolly Moore to win the Fox Hunters for us last year.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. There's the man. We better.
No, it is. But.
Now, here he is live.
Did you ever bet on him?
Come here.
I didn't, I'm afraid, Stan.
But you're pleased, are you?
Absolutely delighted.
Yeah.
Delighted. Spoke to you on the telephone on Saturday night when you had just got home and I was minding the fort back at Steve's.
Oh, yes, right, yes. That's right.
So who are you?
Well, I'm a land agent from Shrewsbury who really should be in the office today.
Tell the nation your name.
My name's James Den.
Well, we had a recording of you there. You were getting very worked up. We thought you must have had about £1,000 on the nose or something.
I ride out for Steve once or twice a week.
That's it. You are a friend of
Steve's. And the horses come past my cottage every morning.
Right.
And the gallop comes round the back of the cottage and is on one of the estates I look after. So
right.
It's
fantastic.
A very, very exciting day.
A bit nervous. I can see by your face still. Yeah.
I've sort of been through this once before because my greatest friend won it in 1990, your friend Marcus.
Yes.
So it's sort of got the t-shirt, but all extremely
well
exciting.
Done. Well, we enjoyed watching you get excited, and that's what this event is all
about. I'm sorry I didn't have any money on it.
Well, we all are, really, but all those of us that didn't. But, you're a racing man,
yes.
Stan. You've been around a lot. And that,
but 35 years.
35 years. Did you get really worked up during
totally,
that?
Totally. Yes. I cheered louder than anybody.
Yeah.
I cheered before it started.
Yeah.
I cheered the way through. We had a winner on Thursday here, the first race, a horse called Midnight Legend, which I bought myself again.
Right.
And third time over hurdles, he won a big race here. And people said, you're cheering. I said, yeah, I could sit. I don't bet, you see. No matter how much I fancy, I don't bet. But I like to see the prize money coming home. I like to see how much value it puts on the he's a stallion, you see, the other horse. So I cheer for all sorts of reasons, apart from betting. You know.
Mrs. Pittman's, one of her runners, was up there for a long time till he took a fall, probably halfway around the second circuit.
Well, that's right. But the horse I was watching was Sunny Bay, because I like Charlie Brooks, I have a horse with him.
Yeah, he's a good man, Charlie.
Yeah, so Andrew Cohen texted Mickey I'd be quite a bit, and it was rather nice to beat him. But I'm really pleased he's done well and come second.
All right. Many congratulations, Mr. Clarke.
Thank you very much, Lisa.
Okay, bye-bye. Let's just take a check now on the starting prices for the race.
The full result of the 1997 Martel Grand National, the winner number 10, Lord Gyllene, at 14-1. Second number 4, Sunny Bay at 8-1. Third number 34, Camelot, places 3. Third number 34, Camelot, places 340, 360, £24.10 for the third. And £9.50 for the fourth. The dual forecast paid £48.40. The straight forecast paid £97.64. And the tricast, first three in correct order, £9,503.36.
And the big camera, the big crew here, everyone around in order to get the presentation, which will of course be done. Lord Darsbury doing the speaking at the moment. Monsieur Patrick Martel, of course, chairman of Martel, and Her Royal Highness Princess Royal, all here on the podium to make the presentation of the 1997 Martel Grand National. Well, Princess Anne herself went down to the saddling boxes before the race, and of course these bronzes are very, very sought after. Philip Blacker has the main trophy there, and Willie Newton, a former jockey, has the individual bronzes. They go, of course, to the other connections. But the one of three horses landing goes to the winning trainer. But Stan Clarke, the winning owner, well, what a popular win this will be, because Stan has really turned around Uttoxeter. He's doing the same with Newcastle, and he's putting his money into horse flesh, and he loves it. He and his wife, Hilda, are real enthusiasts, and you will have seen yourself from his interview with Des Lynam. So Stan Clarke, well, he lifts this very, very heavy Philip Blacker bronze. People have it for a year, of course, but the year that that's sitting on the mantel shelf will be a very proud year, will it not? Princess Royal herself, a former winning amateur jockey. We asked her if she'd ride over the national fences for a bit of a stunt, and she said, certainly not. And it was going to be a bit more of a stunt, I think. Patrick Martel must be delighted that the race has gone ahead now, and especially for Peter Greenhow, Lord Darsbury, to have resurrected it after Saturday. Well, it is a triumph over adversity. There is no doubt about that. And every owner is, of course, a great recipient up on that podium. A lot goes into it. Having a drink out of a hose pipe, the New Zealand bred Lord Gyllene. Now, did he earn that or did he not? I dare say Stan Clarke will be drinking something stronger. Now we have the winning trainer, of course, Steve Brookshaw, receiving his bronze. This is a Willie Newton bronze. And Steve, who is a quietly spoken trainer, is really putting the record right after his uncle, the late and great Tim Brookshaw, put up such gallant performances around these fences, including riding round on Wineborough in second place with no stirrups. So the Brookshaw name finally gets on the winner's trophy, and it will not go to Steve Brookshaw's head. But he's keeping in with the boss. I see he's wearing a Utoxeter racecourse tie. Now, what about the man who did the business, Tony Dobbin? Well, Tony had only had one previous ride in the National. He was unseated last year at the third fence. This year, it was a very different story. He hails from Northern Ireland, where so many of our previous jockeys, top jockeys, have come from. Of course, Richard Dunwoody, a dual winner, also hails from Ulster. And for Tony Dobbin, who'd lost a few plum rides, one man, Unguided Missile, in the past, has come good here with a spare ride on Lord Gyllene, a horse that stayed, jumped, and said, chase me if you can. Well, they chased hard, but in the end of the 17 finishers, none of them had the petrol to quite come back. And in fact, I think, you know, that the horse had a bit more in the tank because he was pricking his ears over the last three furlongs, three fences, in fact. It's a great victory, having, who'd have thought we'd be standing here today after they debark on Saturday? Well, it smiles all round, and I'm sure for everyone who's taken part today, it will be a smile from then. Lord Gyllene doesn't look as if he's had a race, does he? Certainly every finisher will know tonight that he's tired, but they're still keyed up. They've still got that adrenaline pumping in, and that will keep them perky for a while. But I honestly think stamina abounds in this horse's pedigree, and he showed that he stayed every inch of the race. Huge prize here with over £170,000. But that won't really matter to Stan Clarke, because it's winning this type of race that you just cannot buy horses to do it. Occasionally one pops up. Stan has bought a few nice New Zealand horses, and it certainly seems to be paying off. But winners come from all sorts of places. Now, Peter O'Sullivan, in his 50th and final Grand National, would you believe that this gentleman is in his 80th year? After what's been going on in the last few days, Peter has maintained a dignity, a serenity, and of course has been geeing himself up for this moment. A bronze has been produced and unveiled on Saturday, but what a crowd reception there. When he was walking past coaches during the melee on Saturday, everybody was cheering Peter. He is certainly a favourite in any racing person's heart. And the voice has never changed, has it? Well, Princess Royal, who unveiled the bronze of him yesterday, is presenting him now with a bronze for him to remember his time here at Aintree. That smile says it all, does it not? Peter, again, a gently spoken man who gets right to the heart of the matter. He doesn't say anything just for the sake of opening his mouth. If he says it, it is correct. Princess Royal, a great horseman, an Olympian herself, really feels for every connection, everybody's taken part, not only the winners and placed horses and the 17 that got round, but those who failed to reach the post.
Peter today on the 50th occasion doing an impeccable job as always. We'll miss him. Now, for every winner, there's a near winner, and the near winner was Sunny Bay, trained by Charlie Brooks. You thought you might have had it at one stage, did you?
Well, at one point, we were going really well at one point.
Yeah.
I didn't dare to start believing it would happen, because I could see that Lord Gyllene was going well as well.
Yeah.
We made a mistake at the third last, but I think we were beaten by a better horse on the day. It's not a great race to finish second in the National, because it's
indeed not,
nice
I imagine.
To win it, but
yeah. It would have been a special story being a grey horse, too. It's been
year,
well, Nicholas Silver, wasn't it, way back in the 60s?
Absolutely. But in a way, we felt a sense of pride of competing today after what's happened. And we can take that home with us.
Yeah. What did Jamie have to say afterwards, Jamie Osborne?
Well, he was a bit out of breath, you know. But he said, funny enough, he didn't think the horse minded the ground too much. I thought Jamie gave him a brilliant ride, tactically. You know, he was in the right place at the right time all the way. And, you know, let's just hope we're back here next year.
You had a little doubt about running the horse, didn't you?
I was a little bit worried the ground would be too quick for him, but I walked the course this morning and they did a great job. They watered this morning and hopefully just took the sting out of the ground enough to save the horse's legs.
Right. Well, talking of legs, if the camera can pan down a little bit and just look at your leg here, if we can see that. He's got a strapping outside it, Charlie, because you've had a bad knee injury, haven't you? It's gone a bit wrong.
Unfortunately, I've got an infected knee from having two artificial ligaments put in. And I promised my surgeon I wouldn't walk the course. So I hope he's not watching.
Oh, well, Charlie, so near and yet so far, yeah. And bad luck, and better luck next year.
We live to fight another day, Dave.
Absolutely, and so will Jamie Osborne, I'm sure, as well. There's Jamie, just missed out. Seeing him there in his finery for a second.
I think we'll have a good dinner tonight anyway.
Well, of course, absolutely, Charlie. Well done, thank you very much indeed. Well, if you didn't pick the winner or indeed any of the placed horses, where did yours finish? Let's have a rerun of the race now with Peter and with Skew.
Let's go right to the start then, Skew, and pick him up with Simon Morant once again at the head of affairs.
Yeah, it's a bit of a difficult start. They were all up on the tape, but they got away well in the end. And if you look on the inside, there's both the first and second are right up there. Lord Relic and the grey Sunny Bay stands out distinctively. This side is Dexter Dove and Chris Maud, the other grey racing right up there. Evangelica is right up there in the middle, and right on the inside in the black and yellow colours, as I said before, will be River Mandate, because he hangs a little bit towards the inside. Right up there too is Richard Dunwoody on Smith's Band. He's giving him a lovely sight of the first fence. Just coming across Melling Road now, the jockeys will be thinking of the first fence. They've got their position now. They'll just be easing the horses back onto the hocks a little bit and trying to find a good stride at the first fence so they don't overjump.
Yes, and here we can see that just shading them as they go in is the eventual winner. So it's Pillar to Postskew right on the inside, Lord Gyllene there, just heading Sunny Bay. And isn't it amazing that those two should end that way? Huge jumps. The only faller here is Jim Cullerty on Full of Oats. He's just crashing there towards the outside, and it was his first ever ride in the race.
Yes, he's if he wins the Grand National, he won't be the first person to have fallen at the first in the National and picked himself up and won a Grand National. There's Richard Dunwoody in his usual immaculate style jumping, and Straight Talk just running by.
But the field nicely spread out. It did, in fact, take Full of Oats a long time to actually keel over. He may have found a leg there, but just couldn't. Now, the second fence is a nice, easy fence, and they're starting to spread themselves out. There's plenty of time for thinking. But watch as Tony Dobbin Arston gets an enormous jump from the leader there. But nearest to us, nearest to the camera skew on the outside, is Smith's Band. Now, Woody deciding to go very wide.
Yes, he is wide, but he's not losing any ground. He's giving his horse plenty of light. He probably knows that these horses here, like Lord Relic and River Mandate and Sunny Bay, are going to take a bit of ground from him. He doesn't jump this fence too well, this fan. They just took off from the ditch too far. It's a big ditch, this. It's as big as the chair, nearly, and you're always a bit worried. You don't know how your horse is going to react to the fences until you've really jumped this ditch. Chris Maud on the outside having a lovely ride on Dexter Dove. Magoni Beach right up there. Spuffington, Josh's choice, right up there with his ears pricked. Great horseman Philip Hyde getting his horse to jump well.
Yes, and the leaders, all some of them taking the tops out, but you can do that here. Just look to the inside rail. Northern Lad there is being given a great ride by Jason Titley. He's almost taking the paint off the rails.
That's probably another reason why Smith's Band has gone down towards the middle, is because Jenny doesn't want both the horses near each other, spread them out well. In the middle there, the yellow colours, the white noseband, you can see just jobbing up and down, is Master Oates. He ran very, very well for a long time.
Yes, Tony Dobbin again, just getting a little bit close there. He can get some big ones on this horse. Look back on the rails there, the yellow and the Duchess of Westminster colours, River Mandate. He hangs that way, that's why he had to go around the other. We're coming now towards the big drop skew, and you can see that most of the riders are trying to position themselves so they can actually see it.
That's right, they spread out because the drop is more on the inside, but they've all jumped it really well. Already some of the runners struggling a little bit and finding the ground a little bit fast. You know, the fast ground horses like Lord, I'm going to call him Lord Relic.
Lord Gyllene,
Lord Gyllene,
yes,
really bouncing well. Sunny Bay jumps really well on the inside there. Northern Lad jumps well on the inside. New Up just nods a bit. River Mandate over.
Well, let's look at it from the landing side here, Skew. And they're jumping well out over. Dexter Dove, the second of the grey, really got nicely over. Antonin going through the picture. The checks there of Scribbler running well. And towards the back, Fran Woods on Feathered Gale. He was always towards the rear. In fact, he's last at this point. Well, let's take it from our high camera on board the helicopter as Lord Gyllene starts to come across now. This is an angle, not as much as the canal turn, but there's a definite angle there. And it is back bar, of course, that we lose next. Now, here as the
I don't know what it looks as if Glemmott got hit by something. The jockey fell after the fence, didn't he? Sort of looked as if he was shot or something, dived off him, but
we'll pick that up later. Let's now have another look as they turn in. I think they've jumped the canal turn better than I've seen horses for years. Look at Osborne on the grey, Sunny Bay. He's going to go across and he's going to almost touch that corner. The same with Northern Lad and Titley in behind. And they've turned the leaders here. Lord Gyllene, even though he didn't jump it as well or as tight as the grey, actually got a length there.
Yes, he sort of almost turned in the air, doesn't he, Lord Gyllene? You look at him there, he really goes down. Look at that. He's like a Gymkhana pony going around that bend. He really does jump these fences fantastically. He can run into the bottom of all or stand off.
Straight talk going through the picture. Young Jones
in the back there, always struggling. Feathered Gale struggling.
Yes, and that looked very much like Nuko behind them. But look at this leader pricking his ears. He's done this for so far. Lord Gyllene, the grey behind is Sunny Bay, of course. On the outside is Smith's Band, Dexter Dove up there. Then we've got Wild Hyde creeping through. Northern Lad still on the paint. Here's the mare of Angelica in the black and white. But back to the leader skew.
Yes, just... well, Lord Gyllene is jumping beautifully. Smith's Band's jumping a little bit right. Jamie Osborne, the brave route, look right down the inside. Look at that beautiful jump. Smith's Band should have done what he knew out there. You were telling me just here, Richard, how well he was jumping, and that put him at the floor at the next,
well,
I think.
I didn't mean to do that. He had been jumping particularly well. But Wild Hyde Skew had been given a great ride here by Charlie Swan. He's back in fifth place, just off the rails, behind the grey horse, Sunny Bay, and cantering at that stage. But I'm amazed at this New Zealand bred, of course. He's pricking his ears, he's eyeing up everything, very red rummish, although he's not changing...
Richard, we lose there, and he interferes with one or two turning tricks, does, and Johnny Kavanagh does well to avoid him.
Yes,
Stan Clarke bought this horse off, he probably told us already, but he bought this horse off a video. The New Zealand horses really school their horses well before they go chasing, and he's a big fine example. There was Smith's Man. He was jumping right-handed a little bit and just stepping at one or two, but given a usual immaculate ride by Dunwoody.
But the leading three skew are just starting to make a break here. There are a lot of horses still standing at this stage. It does water down from here on in, but I think Don't Light Up is the next faller. It was somewhat hazy at the time, and we're as they cross the Anchor Bridge Road, there's an awful lot of jumping still to do.
Yes, but the jockeys are beginning to settle down now, aren't they? The ones at the back are beginning to realise their fate. They're struggling on the ground. The ones at the front here are just hoping that they haven't gone too fast. They've got their horses jumping. They've got done the first part of the job. They've got their horses balanced, and now they're just concentrating now on just saving a little bit of energy, because it is 4 mile 4 furlong and don't want to be racing too soon.
They also know that now they're facing up towards the grandstand for the first time, that the chair is not so far away. Nice easy fence coming, but there's a horse we hadn't mentioned in the yellow cap we'll see in a minute with the blue and the white sleeves. That was Northern Hyde under Paul Holly. Now he'd been up there right from the start. He's running a very good race. He's out of the picture at the moment, but Tony Dobbin hands down on the horse's neck, the same with Oz, and there's Northern Hyde just going through. They really do try to relax their horses, don't they?
That's right. The jockeys, the style of riding now is to leave the horse's head alone into the fences. They'll shorten and lengthen for you by just kneeling down into them and pushing them into the fence. This has been a tricky fence a number of times this second last first time, but look at Lord Relic. You can see the stride. You can almost see him seeing the stride for you. Sunny Bay jumps it well. Dexter jumps it well.
Wild Hyde Skew. Charlie Swan went between the horse's ears and got back. But on that occasion, of course, we did lose one. I think that was straight talk, you know. But anyway, we'll pick it up as and when we can. We'll give you a complete list. Julian Wilson will run you down them later. Now, wasn't Smith's Band clever there on the outside? Light colours really put a short one in, but they're grouping now all of a sudden.
They are. That's Straight Talk going, I think, Richard, just falling there. Dakin's Boy just going by him. It's usually quite an easy fence. You don't usually see a lot of fallers here, but the jockeys will be worried now about the chair, worried about one or two loose horses. There is a loose horse up with the leaders there, and they really funnel up together to the chair and to the water jump. And you don't want to stand off too far at this fence. This is a brave man's jump and a brave horse's jump. Look at this horse jump. They're right perfect, Lord Gyllene. Sunny Bay jumps it well in the inside. Their Northern Lad gives it plenty of light, jumps it well. Master Oates creeping into the picture. Magoni Beach just going backwards a little bit.
It was Celtic Abbey, the faller there, Skew. But up ahead, of course, let's have a look at it again. Getting in just nicely, not too close. The leaders were good. Let's Celtic Abbey going through the picture. Gony Beach jumping in the red. He got a bit too
Anthony
close.
Going by. Dakin's Boy going by.
That's Newco just dropping his hind legs.
Fettered Gales never really got into the race.
Never enjoyed it today at all. Let's look at it from the landing side. Remember, the ground is raised here.
Celtic Abbey's the horse that falls in the yellow colours on the left. If you just see him in the corner of our picture, oh, he really hits it hard and twists and gives poor Richard Johnson no chance. Interferes with Dexter Dove. Poor Richard Johnson is also lying there trying to miss all the horses galloping over him, Anthony and Dakin's Boy.
And of course, he had been associated with Lord Gyllene, Skew.
Yes, and Lord Gyllene did well to miss the loose horse there because it nearly brought him out through the wing, and it wouldn't be the first horse to crash through the wing there.
No, it's very straight and not very long, but this is generally an easy sort of offence. Well, now, Skew, the jockeys have hunted round. They can start playing at jockeys.
There might be a little bit of a conversation. Here's the water jump again. Here, yes, he was very, very lucky, wasn't he? Very sharp, Tony Dobbin, a little bit like Glenn tore me up the running the other day when he won the 2.5 mile chase. But very good piece of riding.
If Stan Clarke's going to give him a box of chocolates and some flowers for winning, I think he should double it after seeing
that. I think
that.
If he gets a box of chocolates and a bunch of flowers, Tony will be able to give him back and say, that's all you can give me, you need it more than I do.
So this, in a jockey's mind, is what it's all about.
As they say, some of the they'll be having a bit of a conversation now, the jockeys, won't they? They'll be asking each other what's fallen, you know, how are you going? And but once you approach this Melling Road, you shut up again then as the fence comes closer to you.
Yes, and of course, Skew, a lot of the jockeys up front, like Tony Dobbin, will hardly have seen another horse, so they haven't a clue what's been going on behind, but the followers on coming from behind will impart that information.
Yes, but you're hoping that you're creeping into the... You're hoping that the ones in front have gone too fast if you're in behind, and you're hoping that you're coming into the race a little bit. Look at Smith's Band, still just going right-handed a little bit, jumps really... Northern Lad still there in the picture, Dexter Dove coming over. All jumping, it's streaming. Dakin's Boy coming over there, clearly. Newco jumping over. And he's a smashing picture of a Tony Dobbin. Full concentration. Look at the horse's ears. As I said many times, you can see the horse thinking by the horse's ears.
You can. That's the antennae. But the grey horse there is Osborne, again on the pate. He hasn't missed a stride.
Another horse we've missed a little bit coming into the picture and run really well is Valiant Warrior. I think this is where Richard Dunwoody departs on Smith's Band, and it's a really horrible fall. It must be the next one.
Yep,
preempting it a little bit. It's a Valiant Warrior just coming in and run a good race there under Russ Garrity coming into the picture. But look, as you pointed out, how close these two are going to the paint. Some of the riders look for the safer route, but not to Tony Dobbin and Richard Dunwoody.
And Smith's Band really was never going to get away with that one, was he? It got him very close to
horrible,
it.
Horrible fall.
Yeah. Master Oates starting to creep into the picture. But up front, the fall of the loose horse is Celtic Abbey, who really did have a nasty experience at the chair, and yet here he is matching strides with Lord Gyllene. Tony saw a short one there, didn't he? And just hauled back. You cannot go for medals at every fence.
No, you can't, and I think that's been the great asset of his riding. Camelot Knight just coming into the picture. He ran on to finish third, but the great asset of his jumping that he does whatever he wants. So this is Beaches. You can always tell by it by the hedge, and quite rightly Tony's pulling into the middle there to not jump the steepest part of the fence, but he would be worried about the loose horse. Sunny Bay goes right down the inside. Northern Lad goes right down the inside.
It was Master Oates who just nodded a bit there. He's just coming through, isn't it? Or was that Valiant Warrior? Let's have a look at it again. Look where the grey goes, Sunny Bay, right to the corner. A Valiant Warrior just nods a little bit. It was Master Oates well up there. Dexter Dove starting to weaken now.
That was Bishop's Hall, who's been putting up a good one. And over the top, I'm afraid, that was Wild Hyde and Charlie Swan, who'd nearly been unseated earlier. He wasn't having a happy ride, was he?
Antonin just coming over the tail end of them.
Well, let's take a view from high up there.
That's and the Foinaven fence. Now they're coming up to Canal Turn, is it?
No, this is, no, the, this is the Foinaven. But the other one that went there, skew, was Spuffington, Philip Hyde, who's having a terrific ride until this. Now, we'd seen them jump the canal brilliantly by cutting in and saving ground, and they do it yet again. This is the best year I've seen for a few.
Yes, and quite rightly again, Tony Dobbin pulls into the middle of the fence to give him enough room to go back left-hand. And there he is, going back left-handed. Look at that. And the horse, again, like a Gymkhana pony, almost sort of dodging. He's left the last stride. He's almost mechanical around here, isn't he?
And everyone else is following him. Given a lead, you see, jockeys will
exactly.
do it.
As Go Ballistic, the favourite in the middle of your picture there, struggling a little bit. But now, as I say, this is the important part of the race. You know you're on the telly now. You're in really in the contest. The race is really hotting up, and you're hoping that the race really... your horse really run.
Go Ballistic almost fell there. He sat down in time quarters, got back up again. Now, here, what must be going through Tony Dobbin's mind? Have I used up too much stamina on this horse?
But what I love about the horse, he's pushing him into the fence. The old horse is changing his legs and dancing in front of the opposite. Northern Lad making a mistake there. Buckfold Bounce coming through. He's running a race. Camelot Knight's going to run on to finish.
Northern Hyde's there with the yellow cap still, but let's go back with the leaders. And in the red, Valiant Warrior, who's been there so often, for so long, and coming into the picture, you'll see when the shot changes. Oh, Jamie Osborne sitting like glue for the second time this meeting. Just coming back in though, there Master Oates looks a danger. Well, up front once again, Lord Gyllene, lovely long action. Tony Dobbin sets him up.
Look at that. I mean, you're talking about being tired, but I think the way when you see horses jump like that, it really tells you that they're not that tired. They're coming on. They're Northern Lad still jumping well. Camelot
yes.
Light still coming along there, jumping well.
Well, the horses that are just behind the leaders are Abro Anson, who's knuckling in there a bit. Killishin, Dakin's Boy, Antonin of running on from the back. Northern Hyde starting to weaken a little bit. Turning Tricks, who we haven't mentioned much, is still in with them. Pink Gin, again, another one there for Chris Bonner, his third completion in three rides. But skew, now the drama is coming from behind because the horse in front has been there. Lord Gyllene, look at his ears. He's thinking, what's this all about? I'm coming back to the crowd. There's noise, there's colour, and he's actually just coming back under himself.
That's right. I mean, we were wondering here when he during the race himself, was he tired, Lord Gyllene, or was he just having a look around him? Because, you know, Avray Anson has crept right into the picture along the back there, jumped really well for a semi-novice, but wasn't quite able to stay the last bit of the trip out. But you watch this Lord Gyllene jump these last two fences. Look, you can almost look at that. Really clever, pops into it and jumps it well. Sunny Boy, Master Oates has won a terrific race for 11:10.
But what we must say about him, skew, this was such a copybook race of his year. When he won the Gold Cup and came back, he did the same thing, didn't quite last home.
No, he didn't quite get the extra 4 mile for 4 furlongs, but it's vindicated Kim Bailey's decision to run him.
Huge jump there.
And as you quite rightly say, Tony Dobbin must have been really worried up the running. He's a long way in front and the horse is pricking his ears a little bit. And
that was old Newap who was loose. He picked himself up and come on round. But that is a very large gap to have, skew. As they're coming towards the elbow, you'd be pretty confident that that stage you'd hang on.
That's right. He's getting to the elbow now and he never needs to pick his stick up.
So with this now just the straight bit in front of him, Tony Dobbin, an Ulster man, looks over his shoulder. He can only see daylight. Lord Gyllene in front of him, pricking his ears as he sees
it's almost as if Lord Gyllene's saying, don't worry, I've seen, we've won, don't worry, just sit still, son. No, it's terrific. A lovely, lovely picture of a man and horse in unison. What it's all about is this terrific, beautiful looking horse that's made these fences just look so easy. If this horse remains sound, he could be winning nationals for a long time ahead. Could be a whipbred horse, magnificent horse.
And twice this decade, New Zealand horses have triumphed in the Grand National. Well, that is a great advertisement for them. So Tony Dobbin achieves a lifetime ambition in only his second ever attempt here. So often we see this happen, skew. First, second times, in you go. Well, Lord Gyllene, you'd think he was as fresh as paint, but he is an observant little chap. If this was a human being, he wouldn't miss a trick.
No, no, he'd have a chat for the Des Lynam afterwards, wouldn't he, I think, Lord Gyllene, if he was human. But he's Tony Dobbin able to relax now and give a little bit of punch to the air and wait for the congratulations for the young the other jockeys. He must have thought all the others had pulled up.
Well, at the end of the remarkable first Monday Grand National, 18, exactly half of the field finished, and this the official result. The winner, number 10, Lord Gyllene, at 14-1. Second, number 4, Sunny Bay, at 8-1. Third, number 34, Camelot Knight, at 100-1. And fourth, number 8, Buckboard Bounce, at 40-1. Now, these were the other 14 finishers. Fifth, very gallantly, number 1, the top weight, Master Rhodes. Sixth to finish was Avro Anson. Seventh, Killishin. Eighth was Dakin's Boy. Ninth, Jenny Pittman's better runner on the day, Nathan Ladd. 10th was Valiant Warrior. 11th was the little chestnut Antonin. 12th to finish was Northern Hyde. 13th, Turning Tricks. 14th was Pink Gin. 15th was New Co, always at the back. 16th, General Wolf. 17th was Go Ballistic. Go Ballistic, in fact, actually pulled up two out, having broken a blood vessel. And last was Evangelica. So, in fact, we've got 18 finishers there. There was another finisher, which was General Wolf.
And behind them is Camelot Knight, but racing towards the elbow, and Lord Gyllene is sprinting away with the 1997 150th National. A fantastic performance of jumping this by Lord Gyllene, getting a tremendous reception from the crowd. A terrific performance this. Lord Gyllene carries the colours of Stanley Clarke to victory. Lord Gyllene is the winner of the 1997 National. Sunny Bay runs on gallantly to be second. It's close for third, with Camelot Knight getting up to be third, but Ford Bounce 4. 5 was the top weight Master Rhodes, 6 was Avro Anson, 7 was Killishin, and behind him came Dakin's Boy.
Oh, Peter, what's it like watching yourself in action?
Well, it's a little bizarre, Des, I must say. But what a fantastic crowd here.
Absolutely fantastic. I didn't think there would be this many in the beginning, did you?
I believe you lost some money on that, didn't you?
I did. I think I did, actually. But you're a bit like a pop star here today, Peter. You've never had this kind of adulation.
Oh, none. I'm totally unaccustomed to this.
How did the race feel for you? How did it go?
Well, like every other national, it was marvellous. Very exciting. I wasn't thinking in terms of my last national while it was going on. I was just thinking of the race. And it was marvellous to be able to call so many finishers. The real sadness of the day was that there were two horses that will never race again, of course. And I thought the marvellous plus was the enthusiasm of the crowd, the charisma, the electric atmosphere, the adrenaline flowed in the weighing room then before the race. It was just like a Saturday Grand National, which I couldn't believe could be rekindled on a Monday like this. Absolutely marvellous.
You'd had a fairly daunting build-up to today, hadn't you? I mean, like for a lot of people up here, the weekend was fairly traumatic, wasn't it? Obviously, the Saturday.
Yeah.
And then yesterday, hanging about to get your car and all this sort of business. So it wasn't perhaps the easiest preparation you've ever had to commentate on the National.
Well, one of my colleagues said, you ought to know them now because you've had a weekend to learn them. And I said, yeah, but I've had a weekend to forget them as well.
I don't know. I think you're going to miss this, Peter. I think, like a lot of people at the BBC, I think you're going to retire and come back, are you?
Well, I'm definitely not going to do that, Des, no. I hope to carry on, as you know, until the end of November, the Hennessy. And I shall come back, the Lord willing, if I survive that long, as a spectator next year. And get all the pleasure without the... without the worry.
And you had a special honour with the Princess Royal today, of course.
She was marvellous.
Very
yes,
nice.
Yes.
Peter, it's been a privilege working with you on the National. We'll see you again throughout the season, of course. Peter O'Sullivan on his last Grand National. Well, Aintree and the Grand National today, normal service is resumed. Thank you.
there's been some sort of alert, and in fact the whole course now we hear is being evacuated. So what happens from now, I just do not know.
Now we're being told by the police we've actually got to move out of this situation, so
I'll go with that then.
You'll have to go with that, Carl, and I've got to go as well.
This has destroyed the party entirely.
Whoever it is, they should be ashamed of themselves, really, because racing, it has one big day a year, you know, and it's ruined, completely ruined. You know, and it is a great shame.
Stan Clarke to victory. Lord Gyllene is the winner of the 1997 National.